Hello guys, my name is Amit Sani and I'm welcoming you in this daily UPSC MCQ series and mission 2020 we are taking here. 3rd of July it is, and important current affair based questions we discuss every day, and the explanations are important and please follow them religiously, and these all are important lessons. And today's day is also very much unique because many different language StudyIQ channels are launched for Marathi, Gujarati, Bengali, for all of them they are launched. And one important pocket app for StudyIQ's affairs that is also launched, and the name is Pocket News. So that's very important, and for all these subjects you will get updates there on a daily basis. So you can download that on Google Play and you will see that. And these affordable courses by StudyIQ by top faculty, these are also available. The description is given below the video, and you can call on these numbers. And this is the website's address. All these courses are accessible. PDF you will get here on this particular Facebook group. You can send me a request, and you can follow me on Instagram also. And this is the Telegram's link where I upload these PDFs. And regarding that Telegram channel of StudyIQ, you all know about that. Question is that Swadesh Darshan scheme recently regarding the rural circuits, which is a component of it. They are identifying new circuits there. So Swadesh Darshan scheme is launched by Ministry of Culture? No, it is by Ministry of Tourism actually. So this scheme is not a new scheme. It was launched in January 2015. It was announced in budget 2014-15. So from that time they have taken this particular issue in the tourism area, because India has much potential there in the rural area. There is a lot of potential there, and many international tourists and domestic tourists also, they are interested, mainly who are coming from the urban areas and all, they want to know the villages areas, and they go there as a tourist. So that's the case. So many themes are there, around 13 themes are there under this particular scheme, and it was launched with the Prasad scheme, and that was also regarding the tourism area. So 13 themes and wildlife the name is circuit. So wildlife circuits are there, tribal circuits are there, coastal circuits are there, northeast circuit, Krishna circuit, heritage circuits. These all important things are there in the this Swadesh Darshan scheme, and it was launched when the BJP's government came 5 years back. And rural tourism in the country and rural circuit, this is the core issue here. Okay, leveraging tourism and revitalizing the rural economy, and for giving both domestic and international tourists a glimpse of rural aspect of the country. So they may ask about that, and you see they will take funds from all the donors, as in many schemes we have seen they are taking funds from private donors also, and there are voluntary funding issues from the CSR funds. You see CSR are the mandatory funds on the companies and these PSUs and all. Out of their profits, some share they have to give there in the social activities and social responsibilities. So that is the mandatory provision in the Companies Act of 2013. And here also there are voluntary fundings, means it's not a mandatory funding. So they will take funds here, and it will not be funded by states, it will be funded by center mainly. So regarding the financial assistance, center is committed here. So and this would be wrong, this would be correct, and this would be again wrong. So only two is the answer here. And this is all the tourism issue. Next, stride scheme. Stride scheme came earlier also, but now it's a new announcement. It's a new scheme by UGC, and it is regarding the research projects and their support, financial support they are gonna give. They are gonna identify young ones, they are gonna identify their projects, and they will see that which are the high impact important researches and social innovations, social impact of all these projects, how they can support all the growth. And the economy is an important concept here, means how they are going to support the economy there. So E stands for economy there. Okay, so we'll see. It's announcement by UGC, the University Grant Commission. STRIDE stands for Scheme for Transdisciplinary Research for India's Developing Economy. So India's developing economy, and this was announced by Mr. Ramesh Pokhriyal, the education minister, the minister of HRD actually, and research, culture and innovation in the colleges and universities. This is their aim. You see, research area extremely struggling in this country, and finances and all these funds are a major problem here. They are not supporting many of these research projects and all. So that's why we cannot expect much from them. If you want to have some social innovation there and community problems, if they want to have a solution, then researches are important, but these are not funded well. So now this STRIDE scheme, they are gonna bring here, and they will identify young minds there, young talents there, and strengthen research culture there, building capacity, all these common aims. You see, many schemes, we hear these common words, and every time they go with these kind of announcements there, and later accountability is a huge issue there. So three important components are there. In first component, they will identify the motivated young talents, and in the second component, they will work mainly to enhance problem solving skills, and as I told you, social innovation and action researches will be the core theme there. Third is the high impact research projects. They will identify them and they will fund them. In all these components, they are funding here, but here it is just 1 crore rupees. Here up to 5 crore rupees they can give to these important projects and their institutional network there. So it's many subjects they will be funding researches on, like in component 3, philosophy, history, archaeology, anthropology, psychology, all are taken here. Okay, these are apart from the science and technological issues. So culture, Indian knowledge systems, Indian languages, all these things will be supported here. Law, education, journalism, mass communication, all important areas they are covering here. So that's important. Next, Florianopolis declaration. You see, you will not find it very easily because it's a derived question, derived from the issue of Japan, where it has now resumed the commercial whale hunting there. And you see, after 30 years hiatus, means a gap of 30 years, they have resumed it now, because before that it was a phase where whales were hunted up to their extinction, and it's a marine mammal, we all know about that. It's a magical huge and biggest animal on the earth, and whales, actually, they are very much sensitive there. So International Whale Commission is there, and in 82 they brought this moratorium that no hunting would be allowed there. And this International Whaling Commission that works for this particular conservation in perpetuity. So this thing was announced again in the 2018 September meeting, and it was there in Florianopolis, Brazil. So this Florianopolis declaration was regarding the whales conservation. But now in December 18, Japan announced that we will resume this commercial whaling there again, because not much is done this whaling commission and its important workings there, and they could not develop any sustainable method there. So we will have to resume the hunting of the whales again. And Canada, Japan, these kind of countries, they have been opposing this moratorium on this hunting of the whales, and it is really very insensitive of these countries, but they are deciding on their own. So that's the case. So D, whale, is the answer. Whales. You see, International Convention for the Regulation of Whaling, ICRW, is there, and it is being implemented by IWC mainly, and it was signed in Washington DC in December 1946, and in 1982 IWC adopted a moratorium on commercial whaling. And Japan, Canada, they have been opposing there, and you see, they decided that we would go for some major conservation issues. We will establish these whale sanctuaries also. So they have developed, established two important whale sanctuaries till now, and I will tell you about them. Complete protection of certain species they were to provide here, but not much was done here actually in the real terms. And that's why Japan says that we will resume this commercial hunting in territorial waters, and these are exclusive economic zones. You see, territorial waters are spreading up to 12 nautical miles, and up to 200 nautical miles exclusive economic zones are there for all the countries. So in that zone they will hunt down these whales. So it's a unfortunate thing for a huge mammal there. Next, these two sanctuaries, whale sanctuary, Southern Ocean Whale Sanctuary, surrounding the continent of Antarctica, and here total ban on the commercial whaling. And second is Indian Ocean Whale Sanctuary. So here in Seychelles it was established there. Next, the issue of inner line permit. Inner line permit is operational in all the northeast states except Assam. This is a wrong statement. because inner line permit is a specific thing, and it was brought up by Britishers, and they brought this Bengal Eastern Frontier Regulation 1873. But it was their commercial interest that they were saving here, and it was not regarding the tribals there mainly. They were focusing on the tea trade there, and they were focusing on some elephants issue and all. So it was all their commercial interest that they were taking care of. And you do not need any passport there to visit these states where ILP is announced. And you see, Arunachal Pradesh, Nagaland and Mizoram, three important states are there where this ILP is a huge issue. And many times many flouting is there, and central government only issues that inner line permit. If anybody out of those states, if they want to visit these states, then ILP has to be taken there, and it's purely a travel document actually, and it dates back to Bengal Eastern Frontier Regulation, but still it is in a form applicable in the present time also. So it remained after the independence also. And third is wrong, second is again wrong, first is again wrong, because it is there just in three important states. So D9 is the answer. Okay, what is the context there? This important exercise after the NRC of Assam. You see, NRC of Assam is still not completed, and in the same time, in the next 6 months, they are going to complete the Register of Indigenous Inhabitants of Nagaland, so RIIN. And the aim is to prevent preventing the fake Indigenous Inhabitants certificate, because many people they have taken these kind of certificates, and many issues are there. But it's a huge challenge, because it's always a very much active area, a dormant area. Anytime any kind of insurgency can be there. And you see, we brought this UPSPA also in all these states, and Nagaland, many tribes are there, fierce tribes are there, very much rival these tribes are of each other. So many indigenous issues can be there, because they all are competing with all these tribes who are living in the plain areas and who settled there coming from some outside areas. And this inner line permit area is also going on, so that's the case. And it is going to be the extensive survey there, and it will involve official records there. And in September month, they will publish all these details, and then they will invite the claims there. And till October, they will invite these claims, and by December 20, this is going to be completed, finalized. That is the particular time plan of this particular exercise. And here this ILP would be very much crucial. You see, recently in Nagaland, the UPSPA is also extended for next 6 months. So that's always a disturbing factor for all these states where UPSPA is applicable, whether it is these northeast states or the Jammu and Kashmir area. So inner line permit is a different thing. It's an official travel document required by Indian citizens residing outside the certain protected states. So these are protected states actually. And this Bengal Eastern Frontier Regulation, BEFR, is very much important. And at that time, they were saying that British subjects we are saving here. And for travel purpose solely, it is issued. Next question is from the UPSPA issue. As I told you, UPSPA has been extended for next 6 months in Nagaland. And in the same 6 month period, they will complete the RIIN issue, the indigenous register. They are going to complete there. So many issues can be there. So UPSPA has been extended for next 6 months. Now regarding UPSPA, the question is that the government of the state can declare the whole or part of the state as a disturbed area. Is it true? No, it is not true, because only the governor of the state or the central government, means governor is an agent of the central government only. So ultimately the central government has this right that they will declare that it's a disturbed area or not. And you see, we have a Disturbed Area Act of 1976, and in that it was declared that for at least 3 months status quo should be maintained. So before that, 1958, it was the time when UPSPA came. So UPSPA was not brought up by Britishers. It was after the independence of India. Some insurgency erupted there in northeast states. So they have to go for this Armed Force Special Powers Act. So they passed it in 1958. So that was the time. But only the central government and the governor of the state or the administrator of the Union Territory, they have this right that they will declare an area as disturbed area. So first is wrong. Second, fifth report of Second Administrative Reform Commission, Second ARC report, it says that repeal this UPSPA Act. This is not useful anymore. And you see, there was a huge dilemma. Supreme Court also did some readings there, because integrity, maintaining integrity, keeping the country united and suppressing all these revolts and all, and tackling the insurgency, making the area very much normal, it's a ultimate goal of a state, and they have to go with any sense. But you see, for that maintenance, many powers are given to these armed forces, and that was the issue where some misuses happened, according to some allegations that allegations of rape, allegations of killing of innocent people, those were done, and many extreme level of these protests we have seen in the past. One time in the northeastern state, all nude ladies, means they were without their clothes, and they were protesting against this UPSPA Act. They were alleging that the armed members or all these forces personnel, some of them, they are inflicting a lot of pain, they are raping us, and they are killing some innocent people occasionally. So that was a huge protest. Iram Sharmila case, that was also extreme case. For 16 years she went on hunger strike, but anyhow we could keep her alive. And now what is the present situation? Still UPSPA remains there, because it's very crucial to maintain the peace there. So that's the case. So on the both sides there are equal genuine arguments, but which side is telling the ultimate truth, that is to be seen. But second ARC report said that repeal this act and make some changes in the Unlawful Activities Prevention Act, UAPA Act of 1967. Okay, so you can make and you can add some arrangements here in this UAPA Act, but repeal UPSPA, that was the ultimate suggestion there. And as I told you, it was introduced by Indian government only. So all are wrong options here. D none is the answer. Okay, you see, in 1958, when it was applicable to Naga Hills, that was the part of Assam at that time. So in seven sister states in Northeast, it was applicable, and still it is going on in some areas. And you see, in Punjab and Chandigarh also, it was applicable since 1983, and it was withdrawn in 1997. And act passed in 1990 in Jammu, for Jammu and Kashmir, this issue is still going on. Most controversial issue of UPSPA is there, and they are protesting, stone pelting, everything they are doing. And in all these incidences, the UPSPA Act is at the core of it. So armed personnels, they are actually having a lot of troubles. A lot of trouble is there. And they are facing many kind of dilemmas. A lot of provocation is there from the locals, but still they cannot attack these people because arbitrary powers are not given there. But you see, some very special powers are given, and misuse of those powers, allegation is that happened, that misuse happened. And what was those powers means, if anywhere more than five people are gathering, if warnings are also issued against that, and if still these people are continuing with those things or any kind of disturbance, if these people would say, then even they have shooting powers, and even they can shoot without any authority there. So that's the case. But it is not an arbitrary power. They have to do that in some emergency and extreme conditions where some kind of huge threat is there to the peace in the area. So that is the case. But misuses has happened according to these allegations. So that is the case. Okay. Armed Forces Special Powers Bill and Act, it became Act in 1958. That is the case. And these are the powers given to armed forces, and you can read about them in the PDF also. Okay. And the Jeevan Reddy Committee also came regarding that, and Supreme Court also did a lot of readings in this case, and the second ARC committee also suggested that repeal this act. Okay, next, fly ash, a very important and useful substance, but it's a dangerous thing for the environment and for the health both. But you see, it is not still declared as a highly carcinogenic compound or a particular substance by Environmental Protection Authority, EPA. So this is wrong to say that it is a highly carcinogenic issue. Although some crystalline silica is found in fly ash, and that is supposed to be highly carcinogenic, but it is not declared as such that fly ash would be a carcinogenic substance because many, many things, even heavy metals, and PAC is a polycyclic hydrocarbons and all, and some dioxins are also found there, and all are a certain carcinogenic compounds, but as a whole fly ash is not highly carcinogenic as it is not declared as such. So that's the case. Next, there are notifications in India that 100% utilization should be there in all these coal burning plants and all, because it is a byproduct of coal burning. So around these areas, these fly ashes will be accumulated because they are thrown into air. Actually, these are in a gaseous form. When they are entering these upper atmosphere, then they will turn into fly ashes. So many important heavy metals, many important compounds are found in these fly ashes, as they are also found in these coals. When they were formed, then many important constituents were mixed up with that. So these are released in the burning process. So this is wrong, and this is again wrong. D9 is the answer here, and you can read all these details in there, that fly ash is a major source of particulate matter 2.5, and that's again a carcinogenic issue. And fly ash contains heavy metals from coal, large amount of PM2.5, and black carbon is also released, and that is also very much a dangerous substance. But officially on the Wikipedia, all these things are given, and the question has been there many times in the UPSC and in some other examinations also, and they ask you that what are the compounds which are found in these fly ashes. And regarding the uses, there are also very famous questions, because uses are so many. It's so many diverse useful applications that it makes it one of the most important issue to manage there, and that's why 100% utilization is possible there, because it can be a great replacement for the cement also. It's a very nice compound there, which can replace Portland cement sometimes. It can be used in these road making, embankment making, and these dams making, transportation services and all, and it can support the infrastructure there. Engineers need to be very much aware about this issue. People should be aware about this issue. And you see here, ordinary Portland cement, it looks like that, and this fly ash, it looks like that. So contains heavy metals, volatile organic compounds, but many structural qualities, good structural qualities, means it can be there. And you see, bricks are made. These are the bricks made up from this fly ash, and these are very solid bricks there, sometimes more robust than the ordinary cement there. And this is the breakup of the uses. Normally half of the uses are in these cement bricks making, and as a replacement of cement, and bricks are made as 7% of the utilization of it. And these are given by the US government, and you can write them in the points. And other important uses are also there. Other important applications are there, like in cosmetics, toothpaste, stucco, bottles, cellular, concrete, geopolymers, cinder block. Everywhere it has implications there. Applications. Next. What is a Tamil yeoman? You see, it was in news, and people knew about this particular small animal, small creature actually. Tamil yeoman is the name. It's a very funny name, and it's a state butterfly now of Tamil Nadu state. Maharashtra, at first instance, it declared blue mormon as the state butterfly, and now Tamil Nadu is the second state to declare a butterfly as state butterfly, and it's the Tamil yeoman. Okay, C is the answer here. You can see very bright orange colored, a very beautiful creature, and orange in color. Tamil Maravan, they also call it in the local language, and Tamil Nadu has declared its first state butterfly, and only fifth in the country to do so. Fifth, how it is a fifth state? Because Maharashtra was the first to declare blue mormon as its state butterfly, followed by Uttarakhand, which declared common peacock as its state bird, and Karnataka southern bird wings. Kerala went for Malabar band peacock, and now fifth is the Tamil yeoman by Tamil Nadu, and the scientific name is Sirocroa thais. That's the name. Next, Prime Minister Modi ji has constituted a high powered committee of chief ministers, and who's going to head that? And it is regarding the transformation of Indian agriculture. Like many steps, we are again gonna take a step, and I talk sometimes very in a sarcastic way, because many schemes, similar kind of arguments, similar kind of aims, similar kind of dreams they will show us, but what is the result? Committee after committee, scheme after scheme, but what is the result? we have made a world record in Maharashtra in the farmers' suicides case. And repeatedly they deny these allegations and all, and consistently farmers are killing themselves. And again this year there are many suspicions on the Indian monsoon. So what's going to happen? God knows about that. But they have taken a step there, and that should be a good step. I hope so. And it is regarding the transformation of Indian agriculture, all these aims of doubling farmers' income and all, and all these issues, they will be discussed here. And Devendra Fadnavis, the chief minister of the same Maharashtra state, he is going to head that 9-membered committee. And Mr. Narendra Singhji Tomar, the union minister of agriculture, Panchayati Raj, he will also be there as a member. And that is going to attract the investment and suggest the policy measures. And in the food processing growth also, it is gonna contribute there. Okay, 9-member committee. The CMs of Gujarat, Madhya Pradesh, Karnataka, Uttar Pradesh, Haryana, and Arunachal Pradesh is going to be there. Ramesh Chand from the Niti Aayog, he will be as a member. And within 2 months, it is gonna submit its report. So that's the important chapter today. And we will meet again tomorrow. Thanks a lot. Keep watching.